Thank you. Thank you. Those who were in front rebuked him and told him to be silent, but he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have pity on me." Then Jesus stopped and gave orders that the man should be brought to him. And when he came close, he asked him, "What wouldst thou have me do for thee?" "Lord," he said, "give me back my sight." Jesus said to him, "Receive thy sight, thy faith has brought thee recovery." And at once the man recovered his sight, followed him, glorified God. All the people too gave praise to God at seeing it. Announcements for this week. So aftermath plays in Dublin. Tea and coffee, aftermath today, exceptionally because we start the 40 hours of the ration straight after mass. That's why the altar is red, beautiful flowers and candles for the ration straight after mass. Please encourage others to visit our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. 40 hours, even for a few minutes. And you are encouraged as well to come to attend Mass at 7 p.m. Tuesday, short Tuesday, for the concluding Mass. Here is the procession in the church, the Shrine Church here. But we catch up the lack of tea and coffee on Tuesday with pancakes after Mass.
Exactly the meaning of the gospel today. Give
Give me back my sight. I lost that because of the original sins and my personal sins. We know that any personal sin is committing again away the original sin. So what is faith in this gospel and in the light of this of the epistle as well? We have a kind of reflection this morning about faith. Faith in the meantime, is certain and obscure. Is a certainty and darkness. As Saint John of the Cross said, faith is the certain and obscure possession of God proportioned to my soul. This is the, I would say, the obscure definition of faith again. Faith is a certain and obscure possession of God, and a habit of the possession of God. Obscure, why? Because God is in himself, is a mystery for us. Now, in this time, God is a mystery. So that's why faith is obscure. But this is why faith, in what we call in its primary object, God, is obscure. This is why we find believing hard and difficult, because God in himself is very distant from us. It's so perfect. There's such a gap between God and me, because of my sins, but also because of my nature, that if I do not receive God's help to believe, I can't believe. I'm prepared to believe by the grace of God. This is why we know that faith is first a gift. First of all, faith is a gift received from God. This is the obscure part of faith, the hard part of faith, which is true to understand. We must understand that it is hard to be faithful to this gift and to ask God to renew the gift of faith in our heart daily. The clear part of faith, otherwise it would be too difficult to have for us. The clear part of faith is what we call the secondary object of faith. Believe first in God, primary object. The secondary object is the teaching of the Catholic Church, the doctrine, the magisterium, the vocabulary, the words used by the Church to hand out the gift of faith. And this part of our faith is clear. We live in the light of the Church of God because the teaching of the Church does not change from the revelation in the Old Testament contained there and given today and taught today by the sacred hierarchy of the Church. This secondary object is clear for us. And in a world where we have no, I would say the world has lost its compass. This is the clear compass to heaven, the teaching of the Church. And this is clear, and this helps, this teaching will help us to believe in the primary object, in God himself. And these words are important, we call for any of us. The catechism, the words of the catechism, is our important. They cannot be changed according to our personal point of view. We cannot. Because God is God. And the teaching has to show the respect comes from our wickedness, but that's all. Faith is light. Obscurity is just an effect in this life. Third, after obscure clarity, faith is certain. It's firm because faith is a gift. Remind, remember, point one, comes from God and from God's authority, and God cannot be wrong. Cannot be wrong. How do we know that God is not wrong? Just one proof would be the order of the whole creation. When God created everything, the harmony of the world is one of the proof belongs. Thousands of them are not the proof of God's authority. He cannot be wrong. And he rules the world as he decides, with order, peace, and clarity. The second, the nourishment of our faith. Faith is certainly because nourished by the gospel itself. The miracles contained in the gospel, and the greatest one, the resurrection of our Lord, is the greatest miracle, nourishing the faith for the whole generations until the end of this world. Faith is clear and certain because based on the sacred scripture, the revelation, and the authority of the church. But there are temptations against our faith. Any of us can say that he had, or he has, or he will eventually have temptation against faith. Because the devil doesn't want us to keep faithful to this gift, to respond to the gift of God by our saint and holy life. We have to resist temptations. Resist in faith. We resist because we know that any temptation, supernatural challenge coming from our personal weakness or coming from the devil, any of them is by resisting them. We ask, not because we are strong enough to resist, but because of the grace of God, the help. And if we ask God's grace, then we resist in a supernatural way, not in humility, because God will help us. So we know faith is an ongoing work in our soul, but an ongoing response of ourselves in temptation, but also in the tendency to mass sacraments. Fourth, last, for faith is living. As reminded in the epistle this morning, Saint Paul reminds us that faith must be living. It means that faith could be dead. And how faith could be dead? Not deleted. Death. Still there, it doesn't live. Faith doesn't help us to live. This is the dead level, the low level of faith. There is no consequence. Faith we receive by the baptism in our current personal life. No link, no consequence. And this is the death of our faith. Faith is not just a question of understanding the, if you follow me, secondary object, which is the teaching of the church, not receiving the teaching on it, But applying his teaching to our personal life, how very nice. We know the temptation is to think that it's too difficult, or the teaching of the church is too, extreme. But no, too hard. It is old fashioned. There's nothing old fashioned in this teaching, because God is always fashioned, we would say. Always. He's eternal. This faith is that we do things. But when we think that faith has been applied in our life by what we call charity, it's in Paul, with the work, the supernatural work, faith is living in us, living in us. And it's not very difficult in a way, because we, if we know that we live in charity, outward and in and off towards our brethren, we don't need to think if or to ask if we have faith. Yes, we do. Because the charity is the window of the faith. If we live in charity, practically speaking, you can really get all the work.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. much good music could do for subjective names, it does get so hard to hear a name. But something else that interests subjective names, it does not get so hard to hear a name. Something else that interests subjective names, it does not get so hard to hear a name. And something else that interests subjective names, it's hard to hear a name.